Okay, now we're going to have a presentation on dialels from Will Valdar at the University of North Carolina.
Good evening. So I'm going to speak about one of the oldest experimental designs in genetics, the diallel. And what is a diallel? Well, so a complete diallel of, for example, 8 strains would be all possible F1 hybrids of those strains plus the strains themselves. So it's a sort of an all-by-all cross. And if you don't have all combinations, then you're talking about an incomplete diallel. And the analysis of diallels would normally proceed by looking at the phenotypes of those offspring and using the phenotypes and their parentage to try and make inferences about the phenotypes' sort of gross genetic architecture. Diallels used to be a very popular experimental design. Now they're less common. They're still done deliberately, but they do often arise in an incomplete form inadvertently through kind of standard collection of pilot data. And so here's an example. I'm just going to use body weight as an example, phenotype, and this is data from 8 inbred mouse lines on males and females, and this is the kind of pilot data that a mouse geneticist might collect who's interested in trying to dissect the genetic basis of, say, weight, and they'd look at these lines and they'd think, oh, well, you know, maybe some of the contrasting lines are good things to do an F2 cross on, and perhaps they might push the envelope a little bit and not just look at the phenotypes on those inbred lines, but also start kind of looking at some of the F1 crosses and start collecting data like this. And before you know it, you have really many of the elements of what would make a diallel, certainly an incomplete diallel. And this looks a bit like a data dump at the moment. It's hard to see any patterns. But some patterns do emerge when we start trying to visualize this data as a diallel. So let's line up all the mother the strains used as the mother and the strains used as the father, and let's just plot this data. And here what I'm doing is the darker the square, the heavier the average mouse that was in that square. And what we can see immediately is some patterns start to emerge. For example, the light blue strain, which is New Zealand obese strain, NZO. We can see that if we inherit anything from NZO, or rather if we inherit from NZO, we're going to be a fair bit heavier. But also, as we look at this picture, we'll also start to notice some other patterns. That inheritance is not quite symmetric. It seems to matter more when you inherit from the mother than from the father. And so there's a sense in which we're seeing evidence of parent of origin. And then as we look even longer still, we'll start to see some other patterns, or other maybe patterns. This is just the females. If we look at the males, we see that everything's a fair bit darker. We see some of those patterns recapitulated, but also maybe some of those parent of origin effects are a little bit different, less pronounced. In general, when we look at the data as a diallel, we see all these different patterns that correspond to many of our notions about types of heritable effects, additive effects, heterosis or inbreeding effects, parent of origin, epistasis, and then also all the sort of sex-specific versions of those. And the strange thing is that usually when people have that kind of data, they don't analyze it as a diallel. They don't necessarily think of it as a diallel. And so why would that be? Well, diallels, as I said, are a very old sort of design, and traditionally they've been analyzed using this sort of fixed effects ANOVA framework. And so this is for mouse I of mother J and father K, we have sort of additive effect in green, which is often called generalized combining ability or GCA, and a sort of epistatic effect in red, which is called specific combining ability. And if you've worked with many linear models, you'll recognize that actually that's a two-way ANOVA with quite a lot of levels, and it would never really be estimated very well. Between about 1950 and 1978, there was an explosion of papers on diallels. And it's important to note also, this was kind of paralleling the beginnings of people getting used to linear modeling and kind of working out the statistics of just standard linear models. But these papers became increasingly complex and esoteric, and the methods that they contained were defined really only for perfect balanced data, and woe betide you if you had any kind of missingness or imbalance, you had to either discard data or do something horrible, kind of bespoke. The estimates that you would get were all highly dependent on what effects were included, and you had to kind of make these very mutually exclusive choices about that. If you look at this literature, it's sort of vast and intimidating, and it's also full of really heated arguments. And so the result is that ever since then, most geneticists try to avoid analyzing diallels, or at least if they do, they do it in a very limited form, which is a pity, because we can see all those patterns, we'd like to put a number on them. One of the things that really held back that area of diallel analysis, and something which, when it comes to diallel analysis, has actually persisted even through to sort of 2010 or so, is what I sometimes refer to as the random effects fallacy, which is this idea that you can only model strain effects hierarchically, that is, as random effects, if you can faithfully make the argument that the strains were drawn at random. That's sort of, statistically, that's very outdated thinking, and the modern view is, of course, you can make parameters modeled as if they're drawn from normal distributions. You do so to induce shrinkage. It's just another part of the model. And so when we were faced with analyzing diallel data, the first thing we did was we just sort of redid the whole thing from scratch and threw in every single type of effect we could imagine there being, and then use Bayesian hierarchical shrinkage to really control all of those parameters and make sure they didn't get out of hand. It really ended up being a testament to the power of shrinkage. So I'll briefly go through the Bayesian linear mix model, which we call Bayes diallel. So it's got 8 additive effects, 8 inbreeding effects, 8 maternal effects, 27 symmetric epistatic effects, 28 asymmetric epistatic effects, that's sort of parent of origin epistasis, and then sex-specific versions of all of those different effects. And for each type of effect, they're sort of shrunk by a grouping parameter based on basically a random effect. And we fit this using MCMC. And when we apply it to the weight data, these are HPD intervals, Bayesian confidence intervals, we can see we get these additive effects. You can see NZO sticking far out there, these maternal effects and inbreeding effects. And as the parameters are less informed by the data, the intervals get wider, and the sort of middle of the intervals gets closer to zero, which is what shrinkage does. And so we get all of these effects. And the important point to note is these effects are estimated in a very stable manner. There's a lot of effects. If you try to use a fixed effects model, it would be a disaster. But these are actually very stable, to the point that we've actually done this weight phenotype on three completely independent sets of mice, all from the same eight strains. And even the higher order effects right at the end replicate, which is kind of amazing. Because we're using Bayesian, because we're using MCMC, it means that we can get quite creative with how we summarize these effects in aggregate, because of course you can calculate the posterior of any function of those parameters. One of the things that I find gratifying about the Bayesian model is that even before it's seen any data, it's got an answer. The answer is that there's no information, which means that as you add in data, that kind of changes. But if you do have sparse data, you know, the model comes back and says, well, there's not very much information, which is something I much prefer to some kind of unstable result. So there we've got these very wide confidence intervals, and it just says, you know, you need more data. We recently extended this to model G by T, gene by treatment effects, in 2014, and we're building further on this at the moment. I said a bit about, I sort of hinted at what one might use the results of a Diallel analysis for. Okay, it doesn't find genes, but it does tell you something about aggregate genetic architecture. And if it's telling you something about aggregate genetic architecture, then it should also give you a pretty big hint about what experiments to do next. You know, if you come out of a Diallel and you've got this kind of information, maybe you find that actually there's some really strong parent of origin effects that are just in females among these strains. Would that change your decisions about which experiment to do to follow up the phenotype? Well, it certainly should. The eight strains that I use as an example definitely aren't a random set of eight strains. They're actually the founder strains of the collaborative cross. And so anything you find in the dial of these eight strains has kind of obvious design implications. You know, how might I further what further experiments might I do? Well, these are some of the tools that you can use: the diversity outbred cross, the collaborative cross, rixes of those. I'm just going to end on one of the insights that we sort of had during this work, and that is it's very tempting to look at a Diallel analysis and think, well, how can I imagine a big kind of pie that I can slice up and say, well, this percentage is due to additive effects and this percentage is due to kind of dominance effects and so on. And the first thing one normally reaches for with that is heritability. And standard heritability is, of course, a ratio of variance components. And if you think about one of these hierarchical models, the variance components are the things which are least well estimated. They're the things that actually you've got the least information about. And the ratios are even worse than that. And so ratios of variance components aren't terribly useful. They don't generalize well beyond the sample. They're typically highly unstable, very, very vague. Ratios of 11 variance components gets absolutely terrible. But then there's a kind of a paradox here, because we're using these variance components to get really kind of precise, stable estimates of the underlying effects. So why not come up with a version of heritability that's based on the effects, you know, the things that are actually well estimated? And so we developed a kind of prospective alternative that is stable and does generalize well. What in fact we do is we take the we sort of project the posterior through the design matrix of a new perfectly balanced experiment. And then from those posterior predictions, we get a kind of a sort of R squared like statistics. So this is something that's based on not the variance components, but the effects. And it results in something that's stable, precise, and meaningful. This work was due in large part to my postdoc at the time, Alan Lunarsic, and also I'd like to thank all of these people and these funding sources and the organizers for allowing me to go a little bit over time. Thanks for listening.